singing holy, holy Yahweh Almighty.
We're singing
holy.
Shalom, 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 daughters of Zion. This is Sister Jennifer. If you can hear me out there, the show is starting out a little bit different today, but if you can hear me, please give me a sound check in the chat room. This is Sister Jennifer, Straightway, Georgia. Please give me a sound check in the chat room if you can hear me. Working out some technical difficulties tonight. We were supposed to have a pre-recorded show, so we're hoping to still be able to present that to you. If you can hear me, please give me a sound check. All right, daughters, just hold tight. We're going to take a ministry break, and then we should be right back with our pre-recorded message. It's actually a pretty exciting message tonight. It's actually an interview of all the sisters that live at Straightway on the land. So last week we had the elders' wives on, and tonight I pray that you will be able to hear the sisters that actually live on the land. I just want to greet you all, just give thanks and honor and glory to the Most High Yah. And I want to just give a shout out to our beloved pastor and his dear wife, Pastor Dial and Sister Carol. They are in Canada. So pastors have been making a lot of videos. So daughters, I pray that you all are, really taking the time out to watch those videos. I know I personally need to catch up. So it should keep you pretty busy. So we're going to take a ministry break. I see tens rolling in. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. We're going to take a ministry break and then we'll be right back.
Shalom. This is Sister Wenda. I hope that all of you are enjoying the broadcast that you're listening to right now. We appreciate each and every last one of you, our faithful listeners and supporters of the Straightway Truth radio broadcast. We try to make sure that we do our due diligence and do our best to ensure that you have the best broadcast as well as the truth coming to you in the hour that we're living in right now. If you would like to help us in this endeavor, your offering will be greatly appreciated in the work of the Ministry of the Most High Yah. Our mailing address for your gift, offering, or letter of support is Charles Dowell Jr. That's Charles Dowell Jr. And Dowell is spelled D-O-W-E-L-L. 506 Ellington Drive. Ellington is spelled E-L-L-I-N-G-T-O-N. P.O. Box 32, Lafayette, Tennessee. And Lafayette is spelled L-A-F-A-Y-E-T-T-E 37083. Again, our mailing address is Charles Dowell Jr., 506 Ellington Drive, P.O. Box 32, Lafayette, Tennessee, 37083. If you would like to contact us by way of phone, the country code is 1, area code 615-688-3025. That's 1-615-688-3025. You may leave a message there, and be the Father's will, we will do whatever we can to try to return your message. It is our hope and our prayer that as you continue to listen to the Straightway Truth Ministry, and as you apply the teachings of this ministry, that you are finding peace and growth within you, your family, and life as well. Please tell others so that the truth may also have an impact and touch others' lives so that they may enjoy the benefits of the truth of Jesus Christ just like we all are. Shalom, the King is coming.
Thank you.
Okay, daughters, we are back. And I believe we've got everything wrinkled out. I think we got Mother Barb on the line that's going to play the broadcast for us. Mother Barb, are you on the line?
Yes, ma'am, I am on the line. Bless you, sisters. Bless you, Sister Jennifer, Sister Ashley. Joy to be with you. And I'm going to pull
Hallelujah.
This up if you want to give, have you given all your intro and everything for it? Because I can,
yes,
I can
ma'am.
Look for it and get it now. All right?
Yep, we're ready to roll with it.
All right. I'm going to get it right on here for you.
Thank you so much for your service, Sister Barb. I know it's kind of last
not a
minute,
problem.
But you're always ready.
Yes, ma'am, not a problem. And I'm going to put the phone by the large speaker, so it's the best we can do for you, Sister Zion. But hallelujah, you're going to enjoy the show. It's really good. And I'm going to pull it up right now. So bless you all, and we'll talk to you later.
Listening today, we have a special pre-record for you and Sister Ashley here with every single sister on this land before you, hoping that this will be a fun and enjoyable entertainment for you, introducing you to every one of us, introducing you to a little bit of our past, who we are, where we're from. For some of you, you never met us. Some of you, you may never meet us. I know many of you are scattered in other countries. Shout out to all of you. Thank you for listening. Thank you for your support to Sacred Truth Ministries. I want to ask Sister Carol to come and speak first to us. As many of you know, at this point, I've already had my child, so keep me in your prayers and remembrance. It's going to be tough for me to be in during harvest time while all my sisters are working. What is today? March. What is it, Nellie?
8th,
she says. She always knows the date. March the 8th. And so whenever you hear this, you're going to know how long this pre-recorded actually took place. So we're in a dining hall. We're goofing off. We're having a good time. We got a good spirit about us. We are growing together. Can't wait till Passover. And by the time that you've heard this, Passover has come and gone. I'm sure you're going to hear wonderful stories. Bless you, Sister Carol.
Bless you. Shalom, Sister Ashley and Sister Jennifer and all the saints.
And you have been here how long?
Almost 18 years. I guess that's how long we've been here. May of 1998, I moved to Straightway.
And you've been married to Pastor Dow?
Forever.
Forever.
He says 33 years, so it's 33 years.
33 years. So I have questions, sisters, that I'm asking each one of them. And because it's pre-recorded, I wish that you all could call in and ask them questions yourself, but obviously you're not going to be able to do that. We're going to run straight through without your call-ins tonight. Sister Jennifer's on the other side. She's able to stop at any point if you put a question into the chat or if you have a phone call coming in. It just cannot be for any of the sisters because of it being a pre-record. So I have my questions here for you, and I have, Sister Carol, why do sisters fear living the way we live?
First of all, can I give a shout-out, please?
Of course.
Of course, I want to give honor to the Father, first and foremost, being everything to us all, and to the man of Yah, who is a wonderful leader and guide to all of us sisters here on the community and abroad, and to my precious sister, Jennifer. She's always behind the scenes doing things. I can call her for anything, and she's just, yes, ma'am, we'll take care of it. And she's one that I can truly depend on, and I just thank the Father for her.
Hallelujah.
Okay.
So no problem. After 17 years of being here?
18
years of being here. You've seen a lot of people come and go, and you've seen a lot of fears. You've seen, you know, a lot of people with fears of why we live the way we live. But directly speaking to the sisters tonight, why do sisters fear living this way, Sister Gail?
I believe that not just sisters, but I believe people in general fear change. Change is something that if you grew up having to move a lot or being in a environment where you were always having to change, it's a little easier for you. But those that have been a little bit more comfortable, a little bit stable in your life and haven't had to uproot a lot, you know, just everything's just balanced. I believe it's a little bit more uncomfortable for Daughters of Zion who haven't had that. But I believe people in general fear change, fear the unknown, fear the unexpected. So with that said, you know, you see all of us that have done it, made the change, lived this way for some a few years, some for many years, and we're still here and we're blessed because of it.
Hallelujah. So did you have fears? That's a good question, right? All those many years ago?
When we first came to the community, when we first got the land, it was kind of different. We knew not where we were going. Really, I wouldn't say fears. We were so excited because we had seen other places that have done something similar, and we wanted to have the same thing that they had or be heading that way. So mine was just mostly excitement. I didn't know what to expect, but I thought we'd all get here and live here, and everything would be peace and harmony and running through the daisies every day and singing as we worked, and that's what I really expected.
Now he's smiling really big. Hallelujah. So why would, it's kind of a two-part question, because why would most sisters assume that they could live this way? Because majority of people at first, they do believe they could live this way, and I'm asking you, could they?
I believe there's some out there that can, that have a willing spirit, that is willing to do what they're told, live peaceably like this, but it is a complete life change, and I think we think a little bit above ourselves than we're actually capable of doing, and as Pastor always says, a new broom sweeps really well. But then over time, after you don't go to town as much as you'd like, after you don't get to do some of the activities you're used to doing or things like that, after you've had to work in the garden all day and then still go and process food, and, you know, sometimes a murmuring and complaining spirit can come about after that, and that's what we try to avoid. So I think a lot of Daughters of Zion that don't really know exactly what we do and how we work around here and how we have leisure time, I think just the lack of understanding, I think they can, and some, I promise you, there are some out there that can very well do it, but there are some that just aren't ready.
Hallelujah. Did you have to give up anyone or anything to live this way? Did some assume that it's such an easy, carefree lifestyle that you don't have to give up? You want to talk on that?
Well, like everyone else, I had family just like everyone else, mother, grandmother, brothers and sisters and things like that. But it actually was not a hard adjustment at all because I had been separated from my family from pretty much the time I got married. And with Pastor being in the military, we traveled so much. We didn't see family much. So for me, it was a very easy adjustment, which I know that I don't take that for granted, because I know for some that are very close to their families and have lived around their families their whole life, it may be a much harder adjustment. But for me, it just was not.
So I just wanted people to hear your voice. For those who haven't heard your voice, is there anything else that you'd like to say, just to share any tidbits?
I'd just like to share for the Daughters of Zion, we live a quiet and peaceable life. We are growing just like you. We are not at all perfect, but we are going towards perfection. My only admonishment would be to just be content and keep your spirits at peace. Don't let life's cares stress you to the point of sinning. And let's just grow in this together so we can all make it to the kingdom.
Any advice for building a relationship with the Heavenly Father, you know?
Going to Him for pretty much everything. We're some of us that have spouses, we're blessed to have our spouses that help and lead and guide us. But we also have a relationship with the Father. I'm thankful that I have time to be able to go to Him, just me and Him, and I value those times very much. When you go from single to married, you don't have to lose all of that relationship with the Father. We know what the scriptures say, so I don't even have to go over them, about a single woman caring for the world and a married woman, you know, has to care for her husband, and yes, that is very true. But just do not lose. There's a lot of you Daughters of Zion that are getting married soon. Don't lose your relationship with the Father. Continue that on, and your husband will love you even the more so for it.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Sister Carol, for your words. She's going to be sitting in the background.
Hello.
I call on her again. My sister Nelly is next. My Puerto Rican / Hebrew from Miami to here. Hallelujah. And I have questions for her as well. Let me see what I've got for you, Sister Nelly. Of course, please, we know who you are. I'm going to introduce you. How long have you been here?
4 years.
And I already said where you're from, but go ahead and tell the audience where you're from.
I am born... I was born in Puerto Rico, but raised in Miami, and new to Tennessee 4 years ago, so it's been a huge change.
Can you send any shout out? Anybody?
Yes, I would like to send a shout out to my sister Kelly and my brother Joe. I love you guys dearly. Sister Malicia, I love you. Mother Beasley, she always calls her my cook day. Love you, Mother. And Mother Bullock, love you.
So I heard the story. I don't know if everyone's been listening long enough to hear the story about Nellie's reaction when she came across the sailor too. Can you share what that was like? I'm sure there's others out there that had the same response.
Yes, ma'am. When I first heard about, you know, the saints here, pastor, the way he would talk, it was actually very shocking. Although I had been hungry for the Father as a Christian, was very empty. But when I heard pastor, because he's very raw and bold and in your face, I actually rejected him. And I thought he was literally off, you know, in many things. And I thought he was just being very sarcastic and rude, obnoxious when it came to, you know, us Christians. At the time, I thought, you know, he was just disrespectful. And I didn't appreciate the way he delivered the message. But everything he said would make me wonder, you know, could it be right, you know? So I would go behind everything he said, and I was wrong, and he was right. So I started to hear, and I started to, you know, prepare my mind and my heart to receive whatever the Father had for me, because I had already been pleading for the Father to come back to me. You know, I used to be a Pentecostal, and the Pentecostal movement, you know, they're very set apart, and, you know, their mindset is not like the normal Christian that is very open to sin. And I wanted to go back to something that drew me closer to the Father. So hearing pastor and everything he had to say really got me, you know, thinking, okay, this might be what I have been praying for. So I embraced it, and the Father was there within everything that pastor had to say, and this was my breakthrough back to the Father.
So you embrace it, you overcome all the rawness, the rashness, and then you come here for the first time, and your first trip here, I've heard the story from your daughter Erica. Please tell everyone who your children are.
My children, Erica Polydor, married to my son, Mitchell, my sons, Ariel and Gabriel, Israel.
Hallelujah. And they're a big part of our music team. Very talented, very awesome hearts, and good benefits to the community. So you've embraced the truth. Now you've made your first trip here to Straightway. And Pastor often talks about the travel here for some of you that have come straight from, okay, we got Puerto Rican background, we got Miami background, we got a redneck route all the way here once you get into Tennessee line. So talk about what you face.
Well, at first, you know, we're leaving Miami. Pastor had, I was leaving to Puerto Rico in like 4 days, and Pastor told my ex-husband, I will pay for you to come to bless you, because I know financially you guys are tight, and Pastor gave us $500 so we could rent a vehicle and pay gas. So it was a given. We had to come. So we're excited, still in the car, all excited, straight away. Erica, you know, had been in touch with some of the sisters here, so she was tickle pink. Finally, we're going to go meet the saints. We are driving here, and first, I would say 10 hours, we're exciting. We're getting closer, it's dark, we're tired. And my family, we used to watch a scary movie every, what we call, Friday night. Friday night was movie night at my house, and every scary movie out there, every intense drama movie was in our home. And I remember we stopped to put gas, and it was a very lonely gas station, and I'm thinking, okay, get your butt in the car, we're gonna get kidnapped, something's gonna happen. Wrong turn. Every movie that I watched started coming to my memory, and I was like, this is not good. What are we doing? We're in the middle of nowhere. Our phone does not work half of the time, and we don't even know these people. Why are we even going? And everything started to crumble. You know, the spirits were really attacking us. Fear was preeminent, I mean, was ruling us at that moment, and we were freaking out big time. So there was an emergency that happened, and we had to stop in the middle of nowhere. Mind you, it's dark, no street lights. We're in the middle of nowhere, literally. And it's a small little road adjacent to the road that we were on. And we were stuck. And a car started coming near us, and I'm thinking, get the gun. They're going to come and get us. We're going to get kidnapped. Somebody do something. Everybody's panicking in the car. And finally, the person, as they were getting closer, we were able to start the vehicle and leave. The person follows us to the nearest gas station, and they're like, I was trying to help you. I mean, this Bubba looks disgusting. No teeth, fish popping out of everywhere, like warts out of his face. He was disgusting. He was like madman. And we were like, that's like that movie, you know, that we had watched where the people kidnapped the people. I mean, everything was kidnap, kill, murder. It was crazy. But when we finally get here, the gate is shut. So it's like 10:30 at night. And we didn't know what to do, and we didn't want to get shot if we tried to open the gate, because we didn't know what kind of protection system Pastor had going on. So Pastor heard the honk of the horn, and he opens up the gate, and we feel at peace. Okay, finally, you know, we're not going to get killed. We're safe. Thank you, Jesus. He says, okay, get all your luggage dumped in my truck. And I said to the children, okay, guys, be careful, stay close to me, because I don't know why he's taking us in his truck, because we already arrived to Straightway. And we're going down this long, dark, dready road where he's saying we're going to stay at somebody's house, and he says the Beckers. And I'm like, who the heck is the Beckers, and why are we going through this road? Clearly, there's nobody out here. There's no home. We're going to die. They're going to kill us. This is like the movie. You know, we're going to be sacrificed. We are their sacrifice, their blood sacrifice, you know, Illuminati stuff in my brain. When we get to the Beckers, it's Elder Becker and Brother Shane. They both look scary to me. Brother Shane had a knot in his head that I thought maybe he got from somebody trying to fight him to try to escape, and then he got hurt. And Elder Becker just looks like a hitman, just like a killer dude. And I'm like, oh my gosh, we're literally going to die. This is not good. Children, stay close to me. Don't go to the bathroom unless somebody's with you. Everyone, don't fall asleep. I mean, everybody's like in panic mode. And I remember I went to the house, and Elder says, my wife is not here to greet you because she has to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning to make breakfast. And I'm like, there ain't no wife. He's making it up because he wants us to relax. Who gets up at 2 o'clock in the morning to make breakfast? No one. I don't know about anyone in my lifetime that wakes up at 03. I'm like, this is all a lie. It's a plot. I'm like freaking out. And I started praying. I'm like, God, please help us. Please save us from, you know, these people. And I remember I embraced my daughter and we fell asleep. And the next morning, we were at peace. It was like, the father was like, you know, it's a spirit trying to, you know, keep you from enjoying my presence here. And after that, it was peace. My children, I had no idea where they were half of the time. The saints were embracing me, my family. We felt the love, the peace, the shalom of the father in this place. But I warn you, saints, if you ever feel like coming to Straightway, just know that the enemy will use anything that you have done, knowing or unknowing, that has defiled you, any unclean thing that you have done to pervert your mind and your thoughts towards pastors, Straightway, and the saints, to keep you from receiving his shalom. So just know that there is peace in this place. The Father is here. His Holy Spirit abides in this place. And Satan is a liar.
Amen. That story's hilarious. It sounds just like Erica's. Erica, I know you're laughing. So now you're here, your family's here, and awesome attribute you've been. So now that you've been living here, and this is your home for the rest of your life, you're here, we're not going anywhere. Do you think Straightway is a tool to help you actually get into the kingdom now that you're here? You think it's helping you mold your way to the kingdom?
I think that, like Pastor says, the Bible says, you know, iron sharpens iron. I don't think that living here is the way to the kingdom, but I do know that it does help us get closer to the Father, because you can't help but help one another grow. You know, like you say often, it's just after you say, when we come in the dining hall, we can't hide that we are going through something.
Right.
We're in each other's faces, and, you know, we could discern, we could pray for each other, uplift each other, help each other. So, you know, it is a process of growth, and I thank the Father for that. You know, being here has helped me see my selfishness, my shortcomings, where I'm lacking, And I improve daily because iron sharpens iron.
Absolutely. And now that you're here from, you know, Puerto Rico is a pretty mega city, right? Big city?
Well, Puerto Rico, I grew up in the country, but there's areas that have already been evolving into more city life.
Okay.
But I grew up very country.
Okay.
You know,
so.
Pit bucket, the tea buckets with the L house, and taking showers with a bucket, a few drop, scoops of water here and there, like very, very poor. But then I went to the city life, and I was spoiled.
Okay.
I was spoiled in the city, and I had it all, and then some. And coming here, because my mind wanted the Father so badly, I actually embraced it because nothing was distracting. So I was able to spend a lot of time alone with Yahweh when I first came this way, and it's because we think different, you know. We're not thinking materialistic, and we really do get that quietness. So it wasn't hard, I guess, because I was so starved for the Father.
And you went back to your roots, really, from how
yes.
you were raised. So did you have any fears? I asked Sister Carol, did you have any fears that you had to overcome?
I think my biggest fear was not being everything that the Father expected of me. You know, like I felt like I was in a place where everybody met a certain standard,
uh-huh.
and I found myself just so far from it, you know, that I felt like, how can I better get there, you know? And
right.
like you often have said, you know, you look at the sisters and you pick out of all of them, man, I want that, I want this, and that's what I would do. Man, I want to be like Sister Ashley in this area. I want to be like Heather in that
yeah.
area. I want to be like Sister Barb in that area. I want to be like Karen. You know, it's like I would look and I would envy in a good way
yeah,
the fruits that I saw. And it was always just that, you know, just feeling like, when am I going to get to that place where I'm free from all this, you know, old me, you know? I would say, Father, you know, just kill the old me. And then I realized, wait a minute, I have to kill the old me.
Absolutely.
So then I started praying differently, and I started saying, no, you're going to die, Nellie. You're going to die because I'm not going to put up with you no more. So it was constantly me telling myself, in my old self, you're not going to rule the new me that is coming about. So that that is how I have overcome the yes, yes.
So you have any, I don't have any more questions for you. You have any admonishment for the sisters or any encouragement, anything comes to mind? It's kind of off script, so you might be blank at the moment, but.
I can just say to all the daughters that, you know, this way is not easy, but it is so pleasant and so beautiful, you know, and the rewards are priceless. And if they just embrace every day for what it is, you know, yes, we're going to have challenges, we're going to have hiccups, we're going to fall. Like I often tell my boys, yes, we're going to poop on ourselves, but the Father, He's there to pick us up. And He's going to wipe you down, and He's going to say, okay, let's keep on going. You know, He could even carry us till we get, you know, stronger. But don't be so hard on yourself when you see yourself. Because I have often say, Father, I want you to purge me. I want you to cleanse me, you know, teach me and everything. I just, you know, please, Father, you know, every impurity, take it away from me. And then when He starts showing me and what He's going to have to do to purge me, man, it's like, dang, that's me. I don't want to see it. I don't want to go through the stinking pain of the purging and the pruning. But when you come out of that, although it's a stage and a time of a lot of pain, you come out gold. And just to stay encouraged to my sisters, to my daughters, and keep on pressing towards the mark, which is Messiah.
Amen. Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much for your time.
Bless you, sir.
Sister Vicky's next. Sister Vicky's cooking for us today. We cook for how many of us this year? 27, 30? Anybody know? Something like that. Between adults and children. So she's working up dinner. So we're going to squeeze her in here. Thank you for your time, Sister Vicky. Let me pull up my questions for you. I would like to know how long you have been here.
I guess 17 plus whatever.
17 plus whatever. That's a long time, Sister Vicky. And because my next question is, how in the world did you find Pastor Dow? Because it was not YouTube, it was not all those things then.
Okay, well, actually, I met Pastor Val at a meeting someone else was having. And
time out. I hear a lot of the old folks, even my husband, still use the term meeting. Mm-hmm. What was a meeting? A meeting was different pastors, different preachers.
Yeah, it was a different preacher was having a meeting. I met him in the parking lot. The meeting was like kind of an all-day thing, and we broke up midday. People go eat or whatever. Well, I would used to go to different meetings, and I always took a lot of food in my trunk for myself and other people traveled who maybe, you know, didn't have the money to go out and eat or whatever. So I had a trunk full of food, and then he had several of the saints with him from that time they lived in Gallatin. And then I gave him they had on my truck in exchange, because I had a bunch of the healthy stuff. I had carrot sticks, I did have some cookies, I had some others. I had a lot of healthy snacky food to fill you up. And I remember
discipline. He was in the living room, as he often talked about, or in the house, the living room.
I don't know. They're in the living room, the basement, or living room. And then in turn, he gave my children some candy bars.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, that's
how I first met him. Yeah.
Hallelujah. So you have found contentment here, correct?
Yes.
Because you are not the I always say this. Vicky's not the social guy like myself.
No,
you know,
I'm not.
What was your dream, Vicky, when you were young? Tell them.
My dream, even when I was still in school.
Sorry, disclaimer. It's crazy. Go ahead.
Was to somehow get on top of a mountaintop, own it, have my own little private cabin with my own private lake that was only accessible either by hiking or by airplane coming in, and at least a minimum of 100-150 miles from the closest person.
Is that insane? 100-150 miles, though. I gotta laugh. It's beautiful. It's how different how, what's the word for us here? We're all different. Just say, what's the word?
Diverse.
That's the word I was going with. Very diverse. So you had to hear that about Vicky, because that was her heart early on. Like 150 miles from the closest person? What in the world? So, speak about some of the differences, anything that comes to your mind, in the community 17 years ago as to now. We're in ministry. It's all about adding and gathering, completely different from the small family.
Well, I mean, like, you referred to, like, what we did, whatever. I mean, of course, the work is totally different then and now. I know people come here and they think we work hard, and we do. We're busy. We've always got something on our list to do. But it is absolutely nothing what it was like 17 to 18 years ago. Mm-hmm. We didn't have the facilities we have now. We had two working bathrooms, single bathrooms on the whole land. That alone is a big problem for a lot of people. Well, we're often in the garden, sometimes just the light just breaking. We could barely see what we were doing. And then we would be in the garden, you know, pretty much the entire day, just before summertime. If it happened to be your cook day or your laundry day or anything like that, like for instance, at one point in time, Pastor said we did our laundry in the creek. We did that for like a year or so. Everybody washed all the laundry in the creek. At a point in time, kind of adjacent to that, we actually had a period of time we did all of our cooking over open fire pit, also for a stint outside.
Okay.
And if it happened to be your laundry day, your cook day, or whatever, like for instance, I would have a laundry and cook day at the same time, so you're washing your clothes, you're cooking out over in the pit. If it were your cook day, you also did dishes. And what dishes back then included, you did the floor, you swept the floors, you mopped the floors, you cleaned all the tables, you took the trash out, swept all the dishes, and if it was your wireless day, you did your laundry too, you did your cooking too. If it's your bathroom cleaning day, you did your, yes, and I forgot about that. You did milking, you milked in the morning, you milked in the evening, that was before you did your, and it was really busy. And so when people come now and they think it's hard, when Pastor says we have it easy now, we really do have it easy now. I mean, we're busy, But we have it so much easier than what we used to. We used to do all the watering by hand. All the sisters would make lines down to the creek, and we would do, you know, someone down there dipping the water, passing the bucket up, the next person passing, so we watered the whole garden. And it would take, you know, 7,500 buckets of water to water the garden.
So anyone else think of any old story comes to your mind, like, I remember when, you know, pop it up, Sister Carol?
I do remember one time Pastor made a sister and I, the sisters had gotten in trouble for something. Someone didn't cook something well or something, and so myself and another sister had to cook breakfast and dinner for a month. And Tomoko and another sister did all the dishes for a month. So we cooked breakfast and dinner for a whole month. And we were so sleepy cooking, and we'd make up songs to remind us to check the bread in the oven, things like that. It was funny. It was a funny time.
So it's really funny when others think we sit and read our Bible all day, right?
Yes. And back at that point in time, we cooked roughly to 65 to 70 people.
Yes.
Every day, every meal.
And most of it over the fire? Is that when, or y'all had propane at the time?
We had one electric stove.
Okay. One electric stove for 75 people.
And then we went to the cook shack, which was, if you thought it was hot outside, wait till you got in the cook shack.
We'll have it in the greenhouse even, right?
Yes, it'll be hard in the greenhouse.
How many years have you done the greenhouse? Since Ricky's our green thumb.
Ever since we've had it, think we got it once. Maybe 2001, okay. In between there somewhere.
Wow, really? 15 years plus. Wow. Anything else you want to share, Sister Vicki? I just wanted, for some people, that might be the most they ever hear you cook. You're very silent, quiet, 150 miles removed from the next person, individual. So anything you want to admonish to say?
Yeah, I would like to comment on one question you asked me about finding contentment.
Sure.
Yes, I am. At least I believe I'm content. But I would like to make it a comment that I know a lot of people are in the frame of mind that if they get to some place, then they'll have peace, then they'll have contentment, then they'll be happy. And it's not a place. You can be in absolute worst possible conditions someplace and be content, because it has to do with your spirit and your relationship with Father.
Very good word.
And so if people are always thinking, if I get there, you know, the grass is greener on the other side.
Right.
I can't make it here, but I could make it if I was there.
Right.
And if not, you're never going to do anything until you have your heart right.
That's very good. So it's not uproot your chickens and your everything, something up your car, come here.
No.
Right? Okay.
No.
It's not like that. Thank you so much. Go cook your rest. We're hungry. And next will be, I'm going to call Sister Diane up. I'm going to call Sister Diane to the hot seat. Please keep sound checks throughout the show, making sure that Sister Jennifer doesn't have to alter any volumes or anything. Here comes our quiet Sister Diane. I mean, I'm going to look from my... Here we are. All right, Diane, how long have you been here?
I've been here 16 years.
16 years. And you're out of the record, right? So, how many years... or let's say this. How did you find Pastor? I think that's off script, but how did you find him?
That's okay. Through another ministry, Pastor was at a meeting.
We had a meeting.
It was in Louisville, Kentucky. And I came with another couple from Minnesota. And at that point, we had left Minnesota, and there was another, he had a community. And at that point, I knew I was going to be moving around the community, and thankfully it was Pastor.
So, and that was your first exposure to a community? Like,
no.
No, you've seen before.
Mm-hmm.
So, totally foreign to me. So, I asked her, how did you find Pastor now? You answered that, right? You have found contentment here. That's like Vicki's question. Oh, yes? You want to talk about that?
I was just excited, like Sister Carol said, just to be around the saints and live around the saints. I've been in the world long enough and had enough. I would just really want to see anything.
So no one's going to stop you?
Nope.
Nothing, no
nope.
Voice. Speak about some of the differences in the early years as compared to now. I'm asking you one question. Sorry, hold on. Did you have any fears in moving here?
Oh, absolutely not.
Not.
I was excited, yeah.
Wow. So why is it about, because I hear some of the fears from people. Maybe is it because they come for visits or they come and see us so much that they allow fear to entertain? You know, because I end up ministering to sisters that have a lot of, I don't think I could do that. I haven't got to live that way. I don't think this and that. So what do you think about, why so much excitement for Sister Diane and why so much excitement for Sister Carol or myself or Nellie? But like so much fear in other sisters' hearts. What's that about?
I would say they're carnal-minded.
Carnal-minded?
Yeah, but they're still looking at worldly things and lusting after the worldly things.
Not want to live without or...
Yeah, fear of not being able to run to the store, run chase it, or be able to get a whatever, the next new latest phone or whatever.
Whatever. So, when you first think you've moved here concerning this lifestyle, you know, do you have any fears or have you had to overcome any fears in living this way once you got to the land? Because that's a completely different ball game. You know, you move here and then is anything noticed?
No, nothing.
So just use that as a testimony, anything that comes to your mind to talk to them about, like Vicky said, when you uproot your life, and you move somewhere, you're not going to automatically get content if you don't have it in you already. So I guess it's kind of like if you don't have any of the fears, you're not going to develop them. Is that a true statement? Maybe? Anybody? Center on the fear? Take a while.
I think most of the contentment situation, like Sister Vicky said, when you move here, you are going to find out whether you actually have true contentment or not. And that starts where you are now. If you don't start thinking on it right now and meditating on it, am I truly content? Stop doing some of the things that you're doing and you'll find out real quickly if you're content or not. If you're used to spending out of your money when you're really shopping stuff for your own needs and things to spend the same and all that, stop that completely. When you do here, you may not have a postage stamp for a few weeks or months. You may not get a postage stamp for a while. You know, try not getting mail and try not doing certain things. You'll find out real quick if you actually are living in contentment.
Yeah, if you're able to stop doing the things you always do, that's good. So last question for you, Diane, what has tried your faith the most living with the saints, as now he says, iron sharpened iron? What's tried your faith the most?
Well, I would have to say, you know, like we said earlier, that the community's gone through a lot of changes and a lot of people. Right now, where we're at, I don't get tried like I used to. There was a lot of, grinding. Some people just didn't have that contentment. Their hearts weren't here.
Yeah.
We'd get burnt food, stuff tore up all the time just because their vision wasn't
the whole.
Yeah, it was about themselves and they're disgruntled and they're not getting whatever they want, so they're going to take it out. Maybe not consciously, but unconsciously, they're not at peace. So their spirit's radiating or whatever. They don't want to do dishes or they want to run, go do whatever. And
you got to tolerate that.
Yeah. So that's.
Let's try to take the most.
Yeah, because this is my home. This is my life. This is what I've chosen, and
right.
I'm still excited about it. I do it all over again.
Yeah.
So, and when I see other people not happy, then just go. So we don't have to feel your unhappiness.
Right.
Because we're happy. This is where we've chosen.
We're happy. We're not brainwashed.
No, this is my life. I've chosen this, and I've given up everything, but yet I've given up nothing to live this way.
Absolutely.
And so that's kind of what...
Tried to face.
Yeah.
It makes me think of a pastor's story of, like, you know, how he's had to, even all these years later, your husband being a main builder too, go around and still fix some of the stuff from early on because if someone's spirit's not right, the pipe goes in the wrong spot or whatever those building terms.
Yeah.
Anything else on that note? Anything, being an elder's wife, supporting the elders, just any admonishments for the sisters, your last few words, wrapping it up, anything on your mind to encourage them, or could you answer the question, how could you live holy out there?
How could you live holy out there? Like Mother Bullock would say, just pray.
What else?
I don't really know. Just, and maybe like what Sister Barb was saying, trying to wean yourself from having to run
your
having to think, yeah, having to, you know, just try, if this is really what you want, or you think you may want to live at a community, try to start weaning yourself from running and chasing and thinking you need the latest this or that.
Hallelujah. Thank you so much for your time. She's our chicken lady.
Can I give my shout out?
Give your shout out.
Bless you, Sister Brittany, and Mother Zsa-Zsa, and Mother Bullock, and my sweet sisters in South Carolina, Sister Allison, and Justice, and Sister Audrey. Love you all.
Hallelujah. Sister Justice would have been married by the time y'all hear this on air, so we're excited for you. Come on, Sister Heather. Step up. Sister Heather's going to talk so much, I can feel it. She's going to say a little more than yes, I hope. No, just say it. Let me go to her questions. I got them all wrote down, sisters, just so we have a basis for you. I hope you're enjoying this show. Jennifer, if you want to push pause and play Sister Wenda, now's a beautiful time. All right, so Sister Heather, where are you from?
I'm from Grand Rapids, Michigan.
And you have lived here how long?
A little over 5 years, I think.
And you bounced from, you live in Georgia?
Yes, I started off from Michigan to Georgia, Georgia to here.
Hallelujah. Any shout-outs? Did I give you the opportunity? I don't think so.
No, not yet.
Go ahead.
Sister Darren, the same shout-out. So I'm just going to shout-out to Mother Bola, to Sister Zsa-Zsa, to Sister Shay, and to Sister Sophia.
Hallelujah. Well, shout out, double blessings to those of you who are in their hearts twice. So see, we think of each of you. Sister Joy, bless you, all of you in North Carolina, South Carolina, Texas, scattered abroad. Okay, so Heather, do you think, this is a strange question. Stephen looked at me crazy when I gave it to her a couple of weeks or time ago when I said, this is what I want you to answer on the show. Do you think you could have made it into the kingdom without living with the saints?
Well, when I lived in Michigan and I saw Pastor's videos, like the first day I watched for hours and hours and hours, and like I think in my spirit I knew right then that I needed to get to the saints. I can't say for if it's for everybody that you have to live in the same house or whatever with the saints, but
right.
I knew I had to be around the saints.
That's a good sound. Kind of a comment is kind of what Nellie was saying earlier. I mean, you don't have to live this way to make it in the kingdom. When I asked Nellie about, you know, is Straightway a tool to help you make it in, she brings up the iron sharpened iron. It's we love it. It's our lifestyle that we're not forced to live. We, like Zion said, we do it all over again. We do it over again 100 times. But for some of you who may never have the opportunity, finding contentment where you're at seems to be the message this evening. So it has definitely helped you make it into the kingdom.
Yes.
But if you haven't been given the opportunity, or if some of you won't have that opportunity to live in a community, please don't beat yourself up. You can still have a relationship with the Father right where you are. So, what is Straightway to you?
Straightway is my family. It's my home.
Your friends.
My friends. It's my life.
It's your life.
There's no place I'd rather be.
There's no start over. You're not a beaten, battered sister.
Heck no.
Hallelujah. Did you have to give up anything or anyone to live this way?
Yes, I think we've all had to give up something, but like Sister Diane said, you're not really giving up anything. You're gaining, if anything.
You're gaining, if anything. It's so true.
Yes.
You, I took this short on purpose because, you know, just to
get on.
You're midwife. You're my midwife. Our midwife.
Yes, ma'am.
Any encouragement for the sisters out there having home births or taking a step in faith?
Just like I was telling you today, educate yourself, but don't let fear minister to you, because the world teaches you to fear without medical hospitals and stuff.
So don't over-educate.
There's
got to
be a balance.
Got to be a balance. You want to know just enough to have a faithful step in having children. So, Heather, you're released from captivity. I kept you really short.
Hallelujah.
Oh, you want to say anything else? Anything at all?
No, I love all you sisters.
Oh, that's hallelujah. Sweet. Bless you, Sister.
Bless
Heather.
You.
How's everybody doing? Sister Barb is nice.
We're good.
Sister Barb is doing good. Sister Barb. Where are you from, Sister Barb?
Sister Ashley, this is a loaded question. Cut off on this one.
Okay.
When Ashley first got here, you all might not know that, but she came with a lot of fun and usefulness. And one of the things she did is she put together this little booklet. And in the booklet, that question was in there. Where are you from? Every one of us answered exactly where we were from. pastor came in and used it as a blast on us because he said, we are from New Jerusalem. We're from a heavenly above. We're new creatures now. So she sat down from New Jerusalem. But in my earthly life, New Smyrna Beach, Florida.
New Smyrna Beach, Florida. Do you have any shout-outs?
Yes, I do have some shout-outs. I'd like to shout-out to the brothers, the men in the ministry. I'd like to shout-out first and foremost to our head one, and that is Jesus Christ. I thank you, Holy Father, for allowing me to be here today to give a blessing to your men of honor. I thank you for the valiant men. I thank you for our God-called Pastor Dow. I thank you for him and our Pastor Corey, our Pastor Tatum, our Pastor Joe Fox, and our pastor in India, and all the other pastors that may hear this later on in the future. Thank you for the mothers. I thank you for all my sisters. And I do give a shout-out especially to our older mothers, Mother Beasley, Mother Bullock, and all the mothers that do such a wonderful job. We thank you, brothers, and all in the ministry.
So how many years have you been a part of the ministry, or what used to be such a small community and now is a ministry?
Been with the ministry almost 18 years, about a little over 17 years.
Wow, and lived here?
Lived here just a little over 11 years, so almost 12.
Wow, almost 12. And so what has changed the most about this community since your arrival?
Well, Ashley gave us the questions like she said a little while ago, and I was really thinking and pondering about that. And I said, you know what has changed the most? Is our youthful exuberance. We came in such youthful excitement, and not that it's not still there. It is definitely still there.
Yeah.
Right, but we have now a different point in the ministry, and what's changed to me is the sober-mindedness. We've changed from a lot of exuberance and a lot of unknowingness about the Father. We've really grown in the knowledge and the grace of Jesus Christ. And Pastor came to the table, I guess, about a month ago, and he doesn't talk very often to the single sisters or to the married sisters on that point, but he just happened to pass by, and he said, Sister Barb, isn't it really wonderful how much knowledge that we're being fed now, how much things that the Father is giving us to know, and that's really changed a lot. It's just beautiful how the Father, it's like a beautiful flower. It's opening to its fullest ripest stage, the ministry, so it's beautiful.
Hallelujah, good answer. And what did you give up to move this way 11 years ago or so?
Well, I really started laughing about this. I had visited a Baptist church one time while I was still in the ministry, and I was not happy that I went there. I literally ran out of that place after I had Sunday school. But they asked that same thing, except theirs was, could you give up these things? And there were 12 things on that list, and I looked over this while I was sitting in the Sunday school class, and the pastor of the entire church was teaching us that I had made a mistake to be even here. But it was kind of interesting. They could not give up so many different things, and I looked at that list, and I said, I gave up every one of those things, because I was in a transition of actually before I had moved here. So I'll share with you. I wrote a little list down, and I'll share with you some of the things I have given up. At that time, they said, could you give up your Bible? And I looked at that list, and I started laughing. I said, yes, I gave up my Bible. I was determined when my sister-in-law took me shopping for a Bible, I had no clue what Bible. So I picked the easiest one to read, the NIV Bible. I said, man, this is great. Little did I know that in putting some of those verses of the NIV Bible added to a real woe on my life. So I gave up the NIV Bible. I now have the King James Version, and I have some other Bibles that are even greater than Hebrew knowledge of that. I also gave up my earthly life as a husband and three children. And that was really hard for me to do. They were from the Esau's line, the Edomite line, and they did not want anything to do with Christ. So as I moved on in my life, I realized that they didn't want anything to do with me either, because I was becoming very godly and very satisfied with my life in Christ. Also, I gave up the medical community. I no longer have doctors, hospitals, hospital care in my future, unless it be like Pastor has mentioned, that something very severe where I need bone work or something in an accident state. But I don't plan on that with Jesus' help, so I've given up the hospital. I gave up a 9.375-year career as a teacher. I was a librarian, a school librarian, and I gave up that career. I gave up my TV. I do not have a TV or any outside communications outside of a computer. I gave up so-called friends, the lifelong acquaintances that I thought were my pals, my friends, my homies, my forever. They walked away from me very quickly as soon as I started witnessing my life in Christ. I gave up every aunt, uncle, cousin, grandmother, brother.
Right.
I gave up two brothers, two cousins. I gave up worldly music, worldly books, worldly dress, pants, makeup, and all the things that go along with a lifestyle that is ungodly. I gave up jewelry. I even had money stolen from me. I should have gotten inheritances, but my family hated me so much, they took $40,000 that should have been mine for my grandmother's will. So there's a lot of things that I gave up and other people took from me, but I gladly have turned from all that. That's it. But I gave up family functions, family reunions, weddings, funerals. I didn't even get invited to my own family's funeral. Weddings I don't get invited to anymore. They don't want a thing to do with me. I gave up Social Security. I gave up money that that you can get as a result of having worked in a career. I was almost going to be able to have a 10-year retirement pension from my teaching career. And I just heard the Father speak to me, said, if you don't quit right now, you won't be making it. And I said, well, you know what? I don't need that extra few months to work. I want to make it. So, mm-hmm. Yep, so there's times that you get pushed like that, and I'm glad to have given up things for the King.
Hallelujah. Thank you so much for that testimony. Did you have any fear moving this way and living this way, Sister Barr?
I was so excited when I first met them that I wanted my whole family, I wanted everybody to meet her. I wanted all aunts, uncles, cousins, everybody else to come with me. As they started not hanging with me, I realized, wow, it may just be my immediate family. I wanted them to come. And then the fear started ministering to me, oh, well, they're not going to. I prayed so hard. I was such a prayer warrior for my natural family. I've never seen anything like it. I prayed morning, noon, and night. I'd set up for my children. They were not allowed to stay with me when I was I stayed at home. I became a stay-at-home mom, but I couldn't be a stay-at-home teaching mother. So I prayed for them every hour on the hour, hoping and praying that they would come to Christ. But I didn't realize that they actually, were just not going to be invited into Christ's life. And once I realized that, the fear of that overwhelmed me just a bit. Because when I came this way, I knew there was no turning back. I knew that I was not going to be going back to my natural family. And that was the only thing when I got here. I just came here with a little bit of a... Oh, did I really do the right thing? Did they really want me here? Is this the place to be? And it was really funny how the pastor got through that fear. The Father must have put it in his heart to hit me with it. We were in the dining hall, the preacher was going on, and he just stopped a minute and he looked at me and said, Sister Barr, who would tell you that we don't want you here? And I went, the devil? He said, yes. And that killed every fear. But as far as a fear of coming here or that the people would accept me or that my life would be just absolutely wonderful, no, it's just really that last little bit of fear about did I make the right choice for the natural family? Because it's very hard for a mother to give up children, mother to give up a husband. It's just very hard to do that. But when you have gone as long as I did with them pray and watching the fruit of their life, I knew they had just continued to reject me more and more, and that my life here, I would experience that. And the people here have been wonderful. I have had no rejection from anyone except the people that were rejected and have left. So, hallelujah.
Now, thank you so much, Sister Barr, encouraging words. Anything to just end it? My sisters, encourage them. You don't have to say anything, but just something in your mind just to throw in there.
The thing that I would like to wrap it up with is the love for Christ. Pastor taught us from one preaching that he had us listen to. It was called 10 Shekels and a Shirt. It was really a good preaching, and it taught you about selfishness, your desires in Christ. Why are you actually here serving the Master? And, you know, Moses went through that same thing out in the wilderness. He looked at the people, some of that came in the multitude that did not really want to serve him. And once they got to the wilderness, it became very evident. And it becomes evident in a person's walk with Christ. If your motivation is for 10 shekels and a shirt, what you can get out of it, that's really a wrong motivation. So I motivate you all, like Ashley had mentioned on one of her blog talks not too long ago. You'll hear this, it'll be quite a long time ago, but she really hit on the motive of your heart. I would encourage you all to look at the motive of your heart. Pastor taught us from that particular teaching. It's by a man named Paris Reedhead. It's really worth listening to, and you can find it on YouTube.
That's the 10 Shekels in a Shirt.
10 Shekels in a Shirt. And it actually mentions that your whole motivation for serving Christ is thankfulness. You ought to be able to look at Christ, envision him hanging on that tree, giving up everything that he ever had, which was a kingdom, glory, angels, everything, to die in your place and take away all of your sins. And if you can't serve him from a thankful heart and be willing to give up whatever it takes from your life that he asks you for and to sacrifice those things, then you're truly not serving him. And that's why you can look at us as examples. We have given up everything that he's required us thus far. Pastor mentioned to look at your ceiling. What is the thing that's going to offend you? So search your heart and really look at what are you going to hit? What ceiling are you going to hit? Can Ashley actually give up her two children if she has to? I mean, this, you know, she's going to have to do some things. Sister Carol, is she going to be able to do something very, you know, extraordinarily odd? Yes, we are. We're going to have to be able to sacrifice those things. And so I just admonish you, sisters, to really search your heart and just know that everything you give up, the kingdom is worth it. And I thank you, Sister Ashley, for having me here today.
Hallelujah. Beautiful message going for tonight. Thank you so much, Sister Tomoko and Meg. A woman of few words. I tried to keep our question list just as short as Heather.
Thank you.
Some of you, you're so welcome. Some of you may not ever get to hear her talk much, so tonight's the night. You're on the hot spot. How long have you been here, Sister Tomoko?
17 years.
17 years.
Yes, community was built April and May, 1998, came here the same year of October.
Wow, okay. Yes. So almost from the very beginning. But you're all the way from?
Japan.
Japan. Do you have any shout-outs to anybody you'd like to say shalom to?
Yes, my sister Ronnie in England, and Sister Margaret at the South Carolina, and Mother Beasley, Mother Bullock, and Shalom.
Sister
Kathy, too.
Hallelujah. Yes, Sister Kathy. She's in the house right now.
Yes.
Blessing you, Kathy, if you're hearing this. We are remembering you. Tomoko, how in the world did you find this community in Pastor Dow all the way from Japan?
Well, I was already living here. Well, anyway.
In the United States?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
I was living in Michigan. And I was listening to the different preacher. Anyway, he had a meeting, 10-day meeting, tent meeting.
You're meeting again. I used to hear that all the time. What the hell is a meeting? Go ahead.
It was South Carolina. He had a community. I was really wanted to be part of the community. So I went to the 10-day meeting. I was so immature, but I was looking to get into the community. The community. It's so bad.
Was it because of your past history in Japan and how they lived?
No, man. Well, I was the first of Christianity. I listened to that preacher, and I was, how you say, word, saved, or whatever kind of Jesus that Jesus took away my, all my sin. Anyway, so, and I found out to be he had a community.
You just admired it. You just loved it.
Yes, ma'am. First, I went to the church, but realized that's not it because I couldn't see the Sabbath. They continued Christmas, Easter, all the pagan things. I was mocked if I say this is not the way.
Okay.
They just thought, doesn't fit you. And I was vexed. I was vexed around all the people in church, and I don't know where to go. So I just left Michigan and come to the meeting.
Okay.
Everything behind. Yes, ma'am. And I met the pastor there. And I avoided Pastor Dow. I was so immature. I really wanted to get to the community. So I don't want to do anything to do with any people. Anyway, but after the meeting, I went back to the Michigan. Pastor Dow called me, and he asked, he invited me. He just thought the community wanted to bid at me, so I come here. Yes, ma'am.
Did you have fears?
Absolutely. Yes. I was very excited to live in the community, but my flesh was, it was battle. Come from Michigan to here, devil was telling me, you know, like, you are not going to shopping anymore. So you better buy everything you can.
I did.
Right? I had it. See, I was thinking of the lie, but I know it's just a papu kule thing, you know.
Yeah, papu kule.
Yeah, it comes to mind, and also like you are only working there for the no fun. You know, you have nothing else. Just a poor
kule.
Well,
that was true at first, right? The working and not much fun.
It was fun. Working, no man. Working with fish was fun. It was fast, you know. It was fun. I mean, it was joyful.
Yes.
I was very, very blessed to be around the saints. Yes, ma'am. That was a vehicle broke down twice, too. That's, that was so hard to not be, me to not be here. Yes, ma'am. And coming down the road, the poor junkie trader, talking that, they were telling you.
Same movie that Nelly was.
Right. See, this trader, see, so how are you gonna live it like this? That's crazy. Well, as soon as I came to the gate, it was all clear. Yes, peaceful. Yes.
So you have three children here, and
yes,
you bring them from the youth up, from birth. You birthed them here.
Yes, ma'am. It was birthing.
What's the benefits of raising your children on a community system?
Well, every way. Yes,
ma'am.
This is the best place, I believe, raising the children. Yes, ma'am. Well, first of all, I can see that Most High redemption through my children because when I look at my children, they are not like I was growing up at all. They never, join the pagan custom, you know, those at all. They never eat unclean food. They always looking for the Sabbath to come to rest. And also all the fish, they are very excited about fish every time. So I was so blessed to see them to grow up in the Most High. And also, if you live by yourself out there, you are blind to yourself, just your way. But we live here. We Most High eyes everywhere. So you have a lot of collection to be done, and that was blessing because I don't want to be lost.
Absolutely.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Homeschooling as well, and you homeschool them all. How is that? You want to encourage anyone out there?
Yes, ma'am. It's challenging, but it was a blessing. That if you send up to your children to the public school, you have no time to spend time with them. That's just so sad.
Yes.
You know, but I'm really blessed to dealing with even challenging. Yes.
Yes,
you
have to deal with the challenges of homeschooling three.
Absolutely.
And different ages and stages and
yes,
mindset.
Yes, ma'am.
Beautiful.
Well, I encourage mothers, when they are little, it's challenging to be so busy, you know, but when they grow up, so much help you can get. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, and the best place in the world to raise children, I agree.
Oh, absolutely. Also, when there was a raising children, the mother was here, Mother Stone. She taught me a lot of the Bible things to me, and that was very blessing. Yeah, precious to me. Yes, ma'am.
Hallelujah. We miss our Mother Stone. Sister.
Amen.
Tomoko, thank you for your work today.
Oh, thank you so much.
Hallelujah.
Sister Jennifer,
yes,
bless you.
Bless you. I pray, Sister and Judge's name. I pray that each of you, as you hear our voices, you know that we're just real people, you know? We have our real stories and real lives, and we're in the flesh just like you, trying to walk and maintain the spirit every day. Bless you, Sister Angelica.
Hello.
Where are you from, Sister Angelica?
I am born and raised in Southern California, just south of Los Angeles.
So you want to know, whiskey on the beach? Like Pastor Rob, yes?
Yes, ma'am.
He's smiling ear to ear. California. You met Pastor the first time when? Was it the meeting in Fresno?
The meeting in Fresno, yes, ma'am. I think it's January 2012.
See, she's our organized detailist with all the dates and the, what's the thing in the library that keeps up with everything?
Rolodex.
Rolodex, yeah. Angelica doesn't know it, but she really is my Rolodex, right? Okay, Angelica. So how long have you lived here?
I've lived in Tennessee for about a little over 2 years, but on the land I've been here for a little over a year.
A little over a year. So tonight you heard from so many people from the beginning all the way to just about living here 11 years. I've been here 8, down to nearly 4, and on down to our Angelica here is about 1, right? Or 11 months?
Is that 11 months?
A little over a year.
Did you have fears of moving here to San Jose?
Moving to Tennessee? Yes. I've always lived in Southern California. It's like, oh, I'm always going to be here. Why would I want to leave California? It's awesome weather. I could go to the mountains, beach, stuff like that. But I was nervous moving to Tennessee because going from L.A., which is so diverse, I'm all thinking East Tennessee is going to be, you know, I hear about the racism with just a pastor. Like, oh, my gosh, how are we going to take a Mexican, you know?
Oh, yeah, because you're a little Mexican, huh? You want to tell your background?
Well, we'll say I'm Mexican.
Yeah.
So I was nervous, and when I finally got here, it's like, hey, some of the field workers are Mexican, so I'm cool, I'm okay.
The field workers in Tennessee are Mexican, so she's going to say that. Yeah, that's okay. Funny. Okay, so did you have fears moving to community, though? From an apartment in Tennessee, which is where you were, right down the road from here, you know, over here. What was that like?
I remember because Thursday it was on my birthday. When Scott told me the news, he took me up onto the deck. He's like, "You're invited to live here." It was like a nervous shock wave, like in my heart, like
what?
Oh my, this is it? Like, oh my gosh, you know, it's a big decision to make.
Cause you don't leave here.
That's it.
Yeah.
It's a Bishop Banks, you know, the last stop for the pit. This is it. Game day. It's like you got it. I don't know how to describe it. It's like you got to show what you're made of. Like this.
Yeah.
Thing.
No more bullshit.
No, this is it. Yeah. You gotta show what you're made of. You gotta push. You gotta drive. You gotta.
Yeah.
Holy. Yes, ma'am.
So I had a question for you that was kind of probably didn't stump you, but you're probably like, how am I going to answer this? Did Yahweh put you here, or some man like God or pastor, or did Yahweh put Angelica here?
I say yes. It's definitely the Most High, and of course, man would be my husband as well, because he found Pastor originally through his silver videos. So with Scott following the Most High, and the Most High, thank you to the Most High for giving me the ears to hear and accepting the word and taking it in. So yes, through his word, what was originally planned out was supposed to be how it was supposed to follow, and then through Scott being here to help me, I follow my husband.
Absolutely. So this is a tool to get you to the kingdom, you think?
Yes, well, yes.
The iron sharpened iron, things that you didn't see on your own, right?
Yes. All the wickedness.
Oh, but she's so disgusted in herself. We are too. We just smile every day. Why do you believe that anyone would need to live set apart, no matter where they were? You know, not just community. Why do you believe you need to live set apart?
I think you'd be tempted every time. Even with family members, friends, like, oh, hey, I'm still here. Like, oh, it's okay. We're just going to bar. You can have a lemonade. You know,
You
have the drink. I think you'll be tempted still being out in the cities. The Bible has Acts tells you all his people were set apart, gathered together, called Moses out of the city, called Israel out of Egypt. Like, you're meant to be set apart, not mingling with the heathen, Gentiles, it's commanded you to be set apart.
Talk about the benefits of having a home birth.
Home birth? Well, with Judith, had her at the hospital. That experience, going there, it's cold, I would little bit early in the morning, so it wasn't too much hustle and bustle.
I'm friendly.
It's a lot of people, you're not knowing who they are, you're being hooked up to IVs and giving shots, and it's stressful and nervous being in there. After I had Judith, nurses coming in and out, it's not picking on Judith, it's picking on me, and then insurance workers and all sorts of paperwork, but with the home birth, it was so much peaceful. You had your loved ones there, I had my sisters with me. One of my midwives with Sister Heather, and I had Chester there. To be there was the comfort of a home and just encouraging and prayers. And then when the birth was over with, I was in the spending the night at my sister's house.
Right.
It was just comfortable.
And Heather took care of you even after that?
Oh, yeah. Heather took care of me. All of my sisters took care of me. Meals, watching Judith, taking care of my husband, my laundry. Oh, I was stress-free.
Much tip for being out there. Much tip for
being out there. Yes, ma'am. Hallelujah. Thank you to my sister.
Any shout-outs to anybody special you want to say hi to? Anybody in your mind?
There's loads to go on. South Carolina, my Texas sisters, Mother Bullock, Mother Beasley, Sister Andrea, Elder Frank, who she's been on my mind lately, Sister Marjorie in Washington, you've been on my mind as well. Stay encouraged, sister. Keep strong. Hopefully you'll be able to make it to the feast soon. Sister Kyresha, be encouraged as well. Miss you too.
Thank you, Andrea. Is there anything else? Any modest encouragement? Nothing? I mean.
Yeah, just stay encouraged. Just her words. Yes, sister, go back, listen to it. 10 shekels in a shirt. I got that one on my iPod. I listen to that every so often. I need that reminder. Yes, that's a really good.
Parents these days, 10 shekels in a shirt. All right, yeah, some old preachings. Maybe we should share those more and more, even as they come up, you know, on the show, because I got them when I got here. I got a lot of them, but I don't always think about giving them out, you know? So maybe Sister Brett can start typing them in the shows and stuff. Thank you, Sister Angelica, for watching Zeppin with Tomah while I'm live. And thank you, Tomah. Come on up. Thank you, Nellie, for watching Gideon while Angelica talks to us. And we're just shuffling children around. And last but not least, and there's 10 of us. I would make 10, but y'all know me. I don't have to do a lot of talking. This is number 9 for the day and the last one, Sister Tomah. I'm excited that we went over an hour and everybody's, spoke very well. No one was too shy, you know, because we're set apart people. We're not out front in your face in front of camera people. So thank you all for your time. Tomah, I have Where Are You From? And we saw the video where you said, I'm a Hebrew and I was from, remember?
Yeah.
Yeah. Remember? You go, and I'm from. Where
are
you from?
Yeah, it's confusing.
Where
I was born in Africa, West Africa, Liberia.
West Africa, Liberia. Oh, you're talking to a very literal, concrete woman here, so I got to make sure my questions are very concrete, okay? Let's see. How long do you live here as of today?
A year
as of today.
Uh-huh.
And yay! Hallelujah. So you were here right before Angelica. No. Angelica, she said 1 year and a few months. Okay, she was right after Angelica. And so no one's been added since Sister Tomah. Did the Most High put you here? I asked the same question to Angelica because some people think the Most High is going to make a way out of no way and give them a community setting. Or some people think, you know, well, it's just pastor, whoever he picks. You know, a bunch of different opinions on that. But did the Most High put you here or did a man put you here?
The man was the tool used to get me here.
Pastor
was the, yes, I heard the message, and then somebody else has to be used to get me across to Tennessee.
So you were all the way out in
California for 12 years.
So from West Africa, Liberia to California for 12 years. What a beautiful, wonderful, horrible experience. And she's rolling her eyes like, oh man, it wasn't a straight way. Get me the hell out of America. And next question is, did you have fears in moving here to Straightway? Because obviously you have many fears moving from Africa to California, and that's a whole other story if anyone's ever interested in hearing her experience there. But now you're moving from, so you were in California and then you were in Tennessee for a little while working. So from that invite, from the time that you were invited from Tennessee, you know, living a few hours away to here, did you have fears?
Yes, I did. I told the Most High, you know, don't take me straight away because you hear people fall away. I was like, please, I pray, do not take me straight away if I'm not fit for it. And that was my fear because you just hear people fall away. I'm trying to understand why, you know, what do I have to do so I remain? So one of my fear was coming here and then leaving. Mm-hmm. So, yes, I was
able to make it.
Yes, I was very careful.
Very careful.
Because this is a holy ground, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. A set apart way, right?
Yes.
And why do you believe that we need to live set apart? Why is it get out of the city? It sounds like a simple question to us as we live this way, but for some people, they just don't have the puzzle pieces come together like we do. Like, why would I have to get out of the city? Why I gotta live set apart?
You have to live set apart so you will not be contaminated by the world. In order to serve the Most High, you have to get away from the pollution of the world so that you can learn about Him, His ways, His character, how He wants us to live. In Israel, they are people who always have been set apart.
So, yeah, what do you love the most about communal living, about living this way? What's the most, what stands out in your mind?
Everything about me at home, just because when I'm here, outside does not exist to me.
Yeah, like the only place on earth.
And that's how it's been for me since I was little, being in the village. I didn't know the outside world. So living here is like that to me, that I don't know the outside, and
right.
I don't have to worry about the outside.
And we don't even remember the dates. That's why I gotta look at Nellie, because she takes care of a lot of the you know, date stuff around here. So I always gotta ask her, because we don't know dates or what is today? Sometimes we're like, what month is it? And it might be the 15th of a new month. And half of us, if you don't pay a bill or write a check, right, this girl? We don't know. And we definitely got doctor's appointments keeping up with dates. So, yeah, we are out of touch with the world outside for sure. And what is courting? Now, hold on. I gotta be funny because I never heard the word courting until I got here. Which turned out, what is courting, Sister Barb? Is that a term you used to use back in your generation, your days?
I think it was back my mother.
Your mother,
and it was dating by the time it got to my generation. But courting is an old-fashioned term for being with your betrothed or being with the one your fiance, the one that you are hoping to be married to.
It's like a little bit more of a pure term than dating.
Yeah,
your dating is a little more liberal and free. And when I got here, I was like, courting? You know, when I was here that I was courting Doug, I didn't know what courting was. I remember asking Doug, what are we doing? What is courting again? I'm like, ha ha, that was And so, if you don't know what courting is, just take a guess, because that's just the term that we use here, right? Or lacrosse, you know. It's different in the faith, but that's what I want you to talk about, because you're actually getting married. How old are you?
I'm 26.
26. And, you know, for a lot of sisters, they'll wait their whole lives to find a man because their priorities are wrong. We've seen righteous daughters get blessed, you being one of them. So what is courting in the faith like compared to a date in the world? Or would you just like to talk about courting in the faith? Doesn't matter. Where we are these?
It's completely different. In the world, you really are not thought moral, you know, being with this person in the world, like I said, you know, is the man see you like him,
still like the bedroom.
Bedroom, yes.
And that's pretty much what the world shows. But when you come into faith, it's a lot different. Because when you come into faith, there is a separation. Just because this man wants to marry me, he ain't just going to marry me right away. I have to show myself approval just like how he does. So it actually gives you time to work on you and both of y'all getting to know each other, like, truthfully, than in the world. In the world, you could hide all your problems behind, and because of the lust of the flesh, you rather fulfill that. But over here, you are learned in the faith, you will learn how to restrain yourself, and you will learn what it means to be a wife. You watch examples of people like Sister Carol, who's been married for a long time, Sierra, you know, who went through the same steps, Justice, people like that. You get to see different examples of what it means to be courting. You take time apart to really get to know that man, and the man has to set up a home for you. He has to make sure that everything you need is provided for, because you're not out in the world working. You will be a helpmeet, like the scripture says. You know, you will stay at home and do what is needed. So he has to make sure everything is provided for you, so you don't have to stress yourself over that. And that's a lot of burden, you know, on the men. And they like it, but in the world, a man would not work for you like that, you know. So over here, you learn value, like, about yourself. As women, you learn self value about yourself, and to really see how the Most High, this marriage thing, like how connected he is with the marriage. You get to know each other, you know, spirits, you get to talk about, just to get a dirt out of you before you come together during the consummation. You know, it's pure. So courting, I think, in my opinion, is one of the best ways for women to really understand the marriage of Yah, because you have to prepare yourself for the bridegroom, and he has to make sure the place is prepared for you before you guys come together.
Hallelujah. Did I give you any time for
shout-outs?
Anybody in your mind?
Allison, Sierra, all the South Carolina saints, Shalaya, bless you all.
Hallelujah. Any admonishments or any last words from you, Sister Thomas? Anything for us, Sister, to encourage or to rebuke? Anything?
When you come into faith, don't come expecting a husband. Just come, especially like, you know, like a lot of you guys heard on the interview today, that the Most High was the one who moved every single individual that spoke here on this land. Come for the Father. Do not come expecting or desiring a husband, because the wrong attitude, the wrong thinking will get you somewhere that you don't want to be. So come prepared, like Mother Barr has said earlier. Woman to serve the Father. And learn America as much as you can. I'm learning.
Amen. And lastly, what comes to my mind, you being the last one out of here, as well as every sister here, are very hard workers. You know, and you see every kind of individual come through, you know, feast days, visits, whatever. Any encouraging words to those who, you know, they come sit and read their Bible?
Read a Bible, but also know what the Bible says. You're not about to come to a place where your name is written and you don't do no work. That's also idleness. You know, we think that reading the scripture is, not reading the scriptures is being idle, but actually your work ethic is also considered as being idle. So, yes, when you come and there's dishes in the sink, help out. And then when you have free time, like leisure time, like they say in the Apocrypha, then you can grab your scripture and you can read. But just have the eyes to see, to see where the help is needed, and make yourself available, because that is a tribal mindset.
Absolutely. All right, so you have heard from all of us tonight, me being Sister Ashley, the host of the show. I'm in the house with a newborn.
Sister Tamara, Sister Nelly, Sister Tomoko, Sister Barra, Sister Heather, Sister Vicky, Sister Carol, and Sister Diane. This is the core of Straightway. All 10 of us, that's it, 10 classes on the radio, Blessed Pastor. Anything else from any of you? Anything? Thank you all for, yes, Sister Barra, close it up.
Tamara was talking about that, about, you know, about not coming and sitting and reading your Bible the whole time. One of the funny things when the Father started to get me to get up off of my bottom and start doing stuff, I'd say, Father, don't we want to read right now? And he'd say, no, Bible in action. So you all actually allowed to come now and put what you've read and who you are in action. And we delight to see you all whenever you come to visit, whenever you come for Tuesday. So please know that our home is your home temporarily, but treat it as such and treat us like you treat your family. We do love you all, sisters.
Hallelujah. Very good words from all. You can see, sisters, how each of us have something to offer. We're not foolish women. We don't desire the things of the world. I'm going to close it up, and I guess on three, we'll all say, bless you, sisters. One, two, three.
Bless you, sisters.
Hallelujah. I'll be back live soon to come. Shalom to you, Sister Jennifer. Bless you, bless you.
Hallelujah. It's an excellent show. Thank you so much, Daughters of Zion, for hanging in there. I know we had a few technical difficulties with the sound, but it seems like it tried to work itself out. So this pretty much concludes the show. There's a lot of advice given here, a lot of wisdom given here about community living, what it was like just to first come together to live a set-apart life. Very valuable and real information. Nothing was fake about this at all. You know, it's not always an experience. But like Sister Carol said, you know, dancing through the daisies and, you know, always having a smile on your face, even though, you know, those are things that you should work toward. But it's not always like that because you live with saints. You live with people who are just like you. So bless you, Daughters of Zion. Thank you so much for tuning in. Bless you, Mother Barb. Thank you so much for standing by and helping us out. Thank you so much, Brother Steve and Sister Wenda, for the sound check throughout the show. We love you all. And next show, I believe we will have a special guest on. So just stay tuned. And next week, we should have something very special for you. So shalom, Daughters of Zion. Love you all. Have a great Shabbat.
And Yahweh Elohim said,
it is not good for the man to be alone. I am going to make a helper for him as his counterpart.
Holy Yahweh Almighty,
we're singing
holy.